sin runs deep. Your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are. Where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me.
Is our annual meeting.
Got a couple more.
A moderator?
Yep.
And I don't know if we want to give them a save the date for the listening session.
We're probably a little early on that. And the other one that I wanted to share with you is that we are starting to meet with United Interfaith Action. Sandra has been doing it for 4 years. I think some of you are aware of UIA and what the work that they've done in the past. We want to re-engage. We're certainly a strong church in Fall River. They come to us looking for our strength. We look to them because they're acting, and we love folks that are trying to make this city better and the South Coast better. So to that, there is a training available. Chana and I will be participating, but I'm not trying to say that so that you all can lay back and go, okay, never mind, I don't have to do a thing. I want you to at least consider. It's called Leading for Change, Essential Concepts in Community Organizing. It's done via Zoom, and the option is this coming Monday and also February 1st for 2 hours in the evening. So if you have any interest in learning how UIA functions and the process that they follow, please see me. We can absolutely get you signed up for this. But I met with one-on-one with Sandra. She's got an amazing story. I think I can share at least. She was the mayor of her city in Portugal. I mean, just she's got power that I only learned by spending some time talking with her. So. And then, you've already said it, but hearing from the moderator, annual meeting is next week. We'll hold it in the sanctuary. We'll see if I can get the heat on even earlier, but we'll make sure it's warm and we're all here and we can figure out how to conduct our business. Thank you.
I forgot our opening affirmation. God is good.
All the time.
All the time.
God is good.
Will you join me in the call to worship? It is Psalm 133, not just from it, but the entire thing. I will read the parts in the Roman type and ask that you respond with the parts in italics. How very good and pleasant it is when kindred live together in unity.
It is like the precious oil on the head, running down upon the beard, on the beard of Aaron, running down over the collar of his robes.
It is like the dew of Hermon which falls on the mountains of Zion. And together, there the Lord ordained his blessing,
life forevermore.
Our opening hymn is Morning Has Broken. A world in which we had to drive or walk or navigate to get here. We come from a world in which we may have listened to news or podcasts or looked at social media. We come from a world in which we've had conversations. We come from a world in which there was a lot of busyness. And we come here into this place of silence and music and worship. We come here to drop all of that whirling, all of that busyness. We come here to leave those things at your feet and instead to open our hearts and to open our minds, to feel your presence and to hear your word. We ask that you help us to feel you here in this place and that you help us to keep ourselves open to you even when we leave. We ask that your word might motivate us and that your spirit might inhabit us. We ask these things in the precious name of your Son, our Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen. Amen.
Who suffered
scripture this morning comes from Ephesians chapter 4, verses 1 through 7 and 11 through 16. It is printed in your bulletin if you would like to follow along. I, therefore, a prisoner in the Lord, beg you to lead a life worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, making every effort to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to the one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of us all, who is above all, and through all, and in all. But each of us was given grace according to the measure of Christ's gift. The gifts he gave were that some would be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers, to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ, until all of us come to the unity of the faith and of this knowledge of the Son of God, to maturity, to the measure of the full stature of Christ. We must no longer be children tossed to and fro and blown about by every wind of doctrine, by people's trickery, by their craftiness and deceitful scheming, but speaking the truth in love, we must grow up in every way into him who is the head, into Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and knitted together by every ligament with which it is equipped, as each part is working properly, promotes the body's growth in building itself up in love. May God add a blessing to the reading of the word. So there are many versions of a story that are told in different traditions throughout time. The gist is that a number of people come upon a great beast, but they can't see it. Maybe they're blind, or maybe the room is dark. And they feel around themselves, and one feels that the beast seems kind of like a rope. And one says, no, it's not a rope, it's a wall. And another says, I feel a column or a pillar here. And still a fourth says, no, it's a fan. Each, of course, describing bits of an elephant that they can feel, the rope being the tail, the wall being the side, the column or the pillar being the elephant's legs, and the fan being the elephant's ear. Each of us has access to God and encounters God in a different way at different times. Sometimes we encounter God in joy or in sorrow, in love or in grief. And so we tend to describe our experiences with God in different ways because we are experiencing different aspects, different parts of our Lord. Each of these experiences that we have is true. It's just that none of us has access to the whole of God at any one place and time. Now we see through a mirror dimly, then we'll see face to face. There's a reverse of the parable of the elephant, which is a number of elephants stumble upon a person in the dark. And the first one says, a person is flat like a pancake. And the second agrees, yeah, a person is flat like a pancake. And the third says, yes, a person is absolutely flat like a pancake. Perhaps that's why God offers God's self up to us only in small portions, so that we are not crushed flat by the encounter with something so much larger than ourselves. I think of Exodus chapter 33, which describes Moses begging to see God's glory, and God saying, Moses, you cannot handle my glory, but if you hide over there at a distance and wait until I've passed by, then you can see the back part of my glory as I'm leaving. That's the piece that you can handle, Moses. And so Moses sees the backside of God's glory as God passes by quickly, because even the great Moses cannot handle all of God. If a human being comes into contact with a troop of elephants, we end up flattened, right? If one of us were to see all of God, we couldn't hold it all, and we would be overwhelmed. It is only as a community together, in which Chana has experienced God in some ways, and I have experienced God in some ways, and Linda and Donna have experienced God in different ways, when we come together to witness to the ways in which we have experienced God and we listen to each other, we start to be able to get a picture of the whole. We need each other to be able to see more expansiveness, how expansive our God is, so that we can begin to see and understand the whole. Christian community is the opposite of Survivor, the television show. Rather than voting people off of the island, we only come to our maturity when everyone is voted in, when everyone is included, encouraged, supported, built up in the faith. We need each other's differences, because it is only in and through each other that we can begin to see the totality of God, even dimly through that glass. I love our Bible because it is a collection of many different encounters with God over time. So that if we look at the God that that Job has had an interaction with, and if we look at the God that Matthew had an interaction with, and we look at the God that John had an interaction with, we begin to be able to put together a larger picture of our living God. This is why we value witness as Baptists. We haven't done any testimony since I've been here. We'll have to do some testimony someday. But witness is the way in which we hear about the ways in which God is working in and through the people of this church and in and through the community as a whole. So if Jeff and I talk about how the Thursday meal is developing, will both of us, I believe, start with the idea that we had a question, God, is this a thing we should do? And on the same day that we were asking the question about whether the Thursday meal was a thing we should do, past the branch supper door came Joan Warren, who is the marketing director for Peer to Peer, and said, is there some way Stepping Stone can help? and we thought, oh, this is how God works, right? And the very next week, past the door, a different church, Victory Church in Tiverton, came by and said, is there some way we can help? This is how God works. When you hear the testimony that we give about the way God works in and through this community, you start to understand not just the expansiveness of God, but how we fit into God's purposes and plans. Amen, church? Without that witness, if we only have our own witness, if we don't talk about if we don't listen to other people talk about the ways in which they've encountered God, we're impoverished. We're only feeling God's ear, right? And we want to talk to someone else who's holding God's hand or clinging on to God's arm to hear more about the totality of God. We value witness in this church, not just because it helps us grow as a community, but there's so much idolatry in this world. When we think, when we look at the Ten Commandments and we say, you know, you shall have any, you won't have any other gods before me, we tend to think, oh, that's an old part of the Bible that talks about building, you know, making images, and of course I'm not bowing down to an image of an elephant, right? But we bow down all the time to our checkbooks. We bow down all the time to a particular image of what a man or a woman is supposed to look like according to the people who are trying to sell you products to make you look that way, right? We bow down all the time to gods that are not our God. There is only one place, this is the Rabbi Heschel, there is only one medium in which we, church, are allowed to find an image of God, and that is in the people around us, because God created us in God's image, praise God. God created us in God's image, and so if we are looking for God, the best place to look for God is in Melissa and Jeff and Lou. I always feel bad stopping. Like, don't I include Gary? Don't I include Jerry?
Y'all.
Name you every time. In all of you. So this is important. This community, this richness of experience that we bring, this richness of talents and gifts that we bring, this richness of witness that we bring, because this is how we see God, not in isolation, but in community together. God does not seek, and we should not seek, an impoverished sort of unity in which we lose who we are, or suppress who we are, or cut off people that we disagree with. But rather, we come together from different backgrounds, with different experiences and challenges, with different gifts and talents and passions. And we come together into a rich, full maturity that encompasses us all. It's okay, Bridell, just sit. Let it stay. I get distracted. Thank you. So how do we do this? How do we come together? Because it's easy for me to say, we should include all of God's diversity, but then we get frustrated when we find someone who disagrees with us. Well, I think the first thing is that we need to agree to witness to our own experiences of God moving in the world and of God moving in our lives. Witness to the experiences that we have, and don't assume that they're the same as other people's experiences. And then we need to respect other people and listen to their witness, understanding that their interactions with God have been different from ours. And when you listen to other people, you have to be careful, because there are people out there who take God's name in vain. How do we determine whether someone is describing an actual interaction with a living God or whether they're lying to us? God wants me to collect $1 million, right? Wasn't there a pastor who said, right? I don't know. God's never said anything to me about money. Right? So how do we know that the people that we're listening to, the people that we're opening our hearts up to, the people who are witnessing to what they say is an interaction with God, how do we know that they're telling the truth? I always go back to the gifts of the Spirit. We're in Paul. We're in Ephesians right now. Paul also talks about the gifts of the Spirit. You know that something is of God if it has to do with, and he's got a whole list of things that include patience, which is not my strong point, so that's why I remember that one, but other lovely things like loving kindness and peace and generosity, right? So if someone's descriptions of their interactions with God, of the way God is working in the world, fits in with generosity, love, loving kindness, love, self-control, all of these kinds of things, well, then you know it's of God. And if someone's descriptions of how they say they've interacted with God include, I don't know, a motivation of greed or a desire to manipulate the world, we can go through that list sometime. It's worded in ways that don't make a lot of sense to modern ears, things like sorcery. But what sorcery is, the desire to manipulate the world to your purposes. So you kind of have to read through 2,000-year-old writing to understand what the negatives are, but you know what the negatives are. Anyone who's manipulative, anyone who's greedy, anyone who's looking to use someone else for their own purposes, well, then what they're describing isn't of God. And I fall back on those fruits of the Spirit often. I'll preach here for a long time, and you're going to hear love a lot, and you're going to hear fruits of the Spirit a lot, because the gospel is very difficult to live out sometimes, but the core of it is simple. The core of it is to love each other, and how can you tell that you're loving each other? You see these fruits that develop in and through you and in and through your community. So we witness to our own experiences of God working in the world, and we respect other people and understand that their experiences are different, and don't expect that they're going to describe an ear when they're holding a hand, right? And instead we open up and say, wow, I didn't know God was like that too. We use our own gifts and our own talents to build other people up. We use our own gifts and our own talents to help other people grow in the faith. And we witness church not only with our voices, but with our very lives, right? So now I'm in James. What good does it do to say, go in peace, be fed, if you don't feed someone? This church is good at that feeding. How do we do this? We develop our own skills. We listen with empathy, we respond in wisdom, we grow in faith, we drop everything that is not helpful, everything that gets in our way of walking with God, we drop everything that gets in other people's way of walking with God. That's a hard one. And we open ourselves up to discernment as a community. Most importantly, church, if we want to live in a mature sort of unity, not an impoverished one, but a mature one, we need to love each other as we are, not as we wish other people were. Actual love of who people are, where they are in the moment. Nobody else needs our judgment. Judgment is God's. Almost, unless someone asks you specifically, no one's looking for your advice either, right? Right? All they want, sometimes maybe if they respect you a lot, they might ask for your advice, but for the most part, what people want from you is empathy, listening, love, right? Never ask yourself, how can I make someone else change? I'm going to pick someone I don't want to see change. Oh, no, I want you to grow in Christ, but I'm going to pick Shauna because she's, look at her with her hair glowing in the sun. She's like light, right? So I'm not going to say, how can I make Shauna make her hair blue instead of gold, right? Here, have a box of hair dye, right? No, I've got to love her with her beautiful glowing gold hair the way it is. And I gotta love someone else with their gray hair the way it is and say, oh yeah, that's beautiful too, right? So we love every person for who they are, understanding that all of us have fallen short of the glory of God. But we love other people for who they are, as they are, without trying to change them. If someone asks their advice, then you can offer it. But otherwise, what you offer is support and love, and maybe you can help equip other folks to grow with you so that we all grow together in Christ. Never ask how you can change someone else. Instead, ask, how can I serve God here? How can I serve God here? What can I contribute? How can I offer what is needed in this circumstance? We've been sitting in a volatile political situation, not just this year, but 4 years ago. We've been sitting in a volatile political situation for quite a while now, and people are entrenching on one side or another, right? people are getting further and further from each other and building, digging ditches and climbing down into them, and never the two sides will meet. This is a purple church. We have people on both sides of that divide. There are very few purple churches left because people don't like to listen to each other. This church is a point of opportunity to express and experience this mature unity that we can have together. There's a story that I heard. I went looking for the name, and I wasn't looking at the right things, so I didn't get his name. I'll find it for you if anyone's interested later. But there's a conflict resolution specialist whom I have heard, who talks about how he lived in New York, and he lived above a noisy bar. And he would go down and ask the proprietor of the bar to keep the noise down, and maybe the proprietor got people to be quiet for 5 minutes while they were watching the guy complain about the noise. But the moment the guy went back up to his apartment, the bar became noisy again, and it was really interfering with his ability to live his life in his apartment with any peace and ease. And finally it came about that the owner of the bar wanted to open an outdoor patio, a seating patio. And this guy was so angry at the bar owner and at the ways in which this noise had interfered with his life that he got together with all of his neighbors in the apartment buildings around, and they stormed City Hall eventually. I don't mean it, but I mean they filed the paperwork that they needed to and went to the meetings that they needed to, and they made it such that this bar owner was not going to be able to get his patio. There was so much noise from the neighbors that this bar owner, and they were feeling vindicated, right? At least he won't get the patio that he wants. And they were invited to City Hall, ostensibly to hear the restaurant, the bar, little bit of restaurant, I think, bar and restaurant owner, hear the news that he had lost. All of these neighbors went sort of with glee in their hearts, waiting to hear the restaurant owner find out that he wasn't gonna get his patio. Do you know what that feels like? That sort of vindictive glee. But when they got into the building, they were told, yes, you've won. They're not gonna get their patio, but come into this other room first and talk with us. They spoke with a conflict resolution specialist who invited everyone to talk about what they really wanted. And the neighbor said, what we really want is to enjoy our apartments in peace. We don't want noise from this bar. And the bar owner said, if you let me open this patio, there'll be no noise from the bar at all. I will be so attentive and so, like, I care about this patio more than anything else, and I will be on that. You will not hear any noise. And the people had come with the idea that they were going to win and the other guy was going to lose. And it was very hard to get out of that idea of winning and losing. But the more they thought about it, if they won, what was going to happen? The bar owner wasn't going to get his patio. And the bar owner would have been so upset and angry at having lost that the noise in the bar would probably have gone up, not down. Because that's how human beings work when they're in conflict with one another. They keep trying to one-up each other. But instead, what happened was they said, okay, we'll give up this idea of winning. We'll give up the idea of him losing. And we'll make this, it's not even a compromise, it's a collaboration. It's adding value where the value was not before. And the patio was built, and it turns out that the patio was actually a lovely place to go and eat, and so it actually added value to the neighborhood where these apartments were. And the bar owner was so glad that this deal had been made that he really did keep the noise down from inside the bar. As a matter of fact, at nighttime, most people were out on the patio, and so the noise wasn't coming up through the floor and roof the way it had before. Winners and losers, the idea of winners and losers creates less value for everyone. And that's where we have been in the United States. Each side trying to own the other side. Each side trying to make the other side unhappy. Each side vindictive when the other side loses. Deal with it. The principle of conflict resolution is that you listen to people's real needs and desires and you create value for everyone where there wasn't value before, so that at the end of the day, the neighbors are happier, the bar owner is happier, and there's a patio where there hadn't been a patio before. Maturity, church, is not a situation in which one side wins a conflict and the other side loses. Because then the side that loses is bitter and unhappy and wants to come back and win so that the first winners become losers. Maturity is not a purge of people who do not think the way we do. Maturity instead is growing in health and faith and helping other people to do the same until the whole is greater than the parts. Maturity is waiting until the whole community matures into the full body of Christ with all of our experiences, with all of our loves, with all of our needs, with all of our desires, with all of our talents, with all of our gifts. One community larger than any sum of individuals ever could be. So let us listen with empathy. And let us respond in wisdom. And let us open ourselves up to discernment. And continue to be the kind of community that I am coming to know and love, that is greater than the sum of our very lovely parts. So that we might have a mature unity in Christ Jesus. Amen, church.
Amen.
Our hymn is Help Us Accept Each Other. So that we might pray about them together.
Morning, church.
Morning.
Anybody else lose them on top of their head? Where did I put my glasses? where did I put my glasses? Oh, there they are. Okay. So, good morning. Joys and concerns. I don't know, it might be the last one to know, but if anyone didn't get the reference to a purple church, that's just the fact that we talk about the blue side and the red side, and when you put the two together, you get purple.
Yeah.
I know you know.
Sorry,
and maybe I'm the only one that didn't. But that's what, when we're referencing a purple church, it's that we can join together in those.
Yeah, so many denominations are, you know, the Southern Baptists are pretty much all red, right? And
right.
I don't know, United Church of Christ is all blue. Right? So if you're a pastor in one of those traditions, people will stand up and they know everyone agrees with them politically. And the beauty of being an American Baptist pastor is I suspect that half of you disagree with me every time I stand up, but that's okay. That's how we live together. That feels like health to me, rather than sort of making an enclave of like-thinking people. We are like-thinking people, but the thing that binds us together is that Jesus is Lord.
Amen.
And not some political saint.
Correct. But staying in that topic, I certainly want to lift the joy of a peaceful transition of power.
Praise God.
Watched the inauguration, there were moments. I was crying, but that's me. So that, and those were tears of joy. Those were absolute joy. Though we certainly want to pray for Lucy, who had a what happened? I forget that.
It's always something. It was a rough night.
For Luz or for Lucy?
Both.
For both.
For both of them. So. Yes, Jane. Yes, I'm glad she, Amanda Gordon, the youth poet laureate, that if you did see the inauguration, it was stunning. So Jane's lifting up Amanda and all that she was able to bring to that day, including yellow that just, I don't think anyone else can wear yellow now because she wore it. Camille, I didn't ask. Same. Camille is on her journey. So, and thank you for every joy is that anybody got here today, because the everybody should have pulled up the blanket and said, "Wow, it's cold outside."
Come on, we're New Englanders.
Yes, we are. So, okay. All right, you know, we want to pray for Ann and Bob and Gabby and all.
Sue
Holland, absolutely, thank you. And those that can't be here. We send the love of First Baptist out to Edgar and Claudette and Betty Marsden and all those that we are missing.
Mm-hmm. Will you pray with me? Father, we lift up to you the beauty of the day. We lift up to you the chill that some of us enjoy more than others, but the sunshine that all of us enjoy. We lift up to you the beauty of the music. We lift up to you the beauty of Amanda's poetry. We lift up to you the tears of joy when we encounter things of beauty, things of faith, when we encounter goodness. Father, we are so grateful for all of the beauty and the goodness that you put in our lives, and the many blessings that you shower upon us. Father, we pray for all people in their daily life and work, for our families, friends, and neighbors, and for those who are alone. We pray for this community, for this nation that we love. We pray for the whole world, for all who work for justice, freedom, and peace. We pray for the just and proper use of your creation. And we pray for victims of hunger, fear, injustice, and oppression. We pray for those who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble, and for those who minister to the sick, the friendless, and the needy. We pray for the peace and unity of the Church of God, Father, that we might have a mature unity that celebrates our diversity, but that keeps you and your love and your goodness at its center. Father, we pray also for those who are sick. We pray for those who are in trouble. We pray for Anne and Bob that they might have all sorts of health. We pray for Camille that she might be surrounded by people who love her and that she might have comfort for the rest of her life. We pray for Luz and Lucy that you would give them many, many, many more good days together and not very many bad ones. We pray for baby Gabi that she too might also be surrounded by love and know herself to be surrounded by love and that she might be kept comfortable in her body. And we pray for Sue Holland for her health. Father, we pray for all who cannot be with us that you would keep them healthy and that you would, where possible, bring them back to us when it is safe for them to come back. Father, we pray that it will be safe soon for us all to gather together under one roof without worrying about transmission of this virus. We pray in the meantime that all might know themselves to be loved, to be surrounded in love, to be part of this community, that they might not feel so isolated or alone. Let your loving kindness be upon them who put their trust in you. Father, we also pray to you for the forgiveness of sins. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father, and in your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone. And so uphold us by your Spirit that we might live and serve you in newness of life to the honor and glory of your name. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We have an offering box at the back. You may have put your offering, your pledges, tithes, offerings in on the way in. If you have not, you might put them in on the way out. And we ask, Father, that you would bless the gifts, the tithes, the offerings that we bring, and that you would bless us, that they and we might be useful for your kingdom. And now, as Jesus taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Our closing hymn is For the Healing of the Nation.
Help us rise and pray.
go now with open hearts and listening ears to witness to God's love and to hear other people's witness. Go now in love and wisdom in the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.
Blessed be God. Blessed be His holy name. Blessed be Jesus, true God and true man. Blessed be the name of Jesus. Blessed be His most sacred heart. Blessed be Jesus in His holiness. Blessed be the Holy Spirit. Jesus, rest his name.